on hard copy.
I'm going to take over everything. I already did.
Charles Manson today.
Don't know how to behave.
Pirated jail video exclusive. Also, the women who killed for him. And the new women who write love letters. Exclusive from Inside Prison, a pirated videotape of the real Charles Manson 20 years after he was convicted. A special investigation into the Manson cult, the days before the Sharon Tate murder. The days of free love with his female followers. One a straight-A student, one a homecoming queen, another a Bible student. From the days on his desert ranch to today's pirated video from a jail cell. Never broadcast before, a chilling document. The real Charles Manson and the new women who write hundreds of love letters even today. A hard copy special report for Monday, February 4th, 1991. Hello and welcome. I'm Terry Murphy. Charles Manson, he professed himself as Satan on Earth. And while he holds court from his cell 20 years later, there is in many of us a sense of unfinished business. Our Doug Bruckner looks into the soul of Satan then and now.
They came out of the night dressed in black. Killers invading a home filled with Hollywood's beautiful people. Their unparalleled savagery dedicated to a twisted vision called Helter Skelter.
Look out! Helter Skelter! Helter Skelter!
Glamorous movie star Sharon Tate was the most famous of the seven victims slaughtered over two nights of stabbing and shooting.
Sharon Tate, poor Sharon, was stabbed 16 times, somewhere in the abdominal area. You know, she was pregnant, 8.5 months pregnant. I mean, you don't even see things like that in horror movies. Young girls dressed in black, armed with sharp knives, entering the homes of complete strangers in the middle of the night and stabbing them to death.
When Charles Manson and his cult, his family, were convicted of the crimes, there was horror even in the White House. Most terrifying to a shocked America, three of the killers were young women, ages 20 and 21. Atkins, Van Houten, and Krenwinkel projected an eerie aura of controlled craziness. Backgrounds gave no hint of their potential for violence. Leslie Van Houten had been a straight-A student and homecoming queen. Patricia Krenwinkel had studied the Bible and aspired to be a nun. Susan Atkins had been a gentle flower child. All killed for Manson, and even today, disturbed people seek his direction and want to join his family. Why? Tonight, some answers in a hard copy exclusive from Inside Prison on a pirate videotape never broadcast before. Manson shows off his powers, his use of music, drugs, mind control.
I don't have to hit you. I don't have to cut you. I don't have to shoot you. All I have to do is think about that.
Charles Manson, now 56 years old, is expected to die in prison. He had a long criminal history before the murders: burglary, pimping, car theft, forgery. The story of the Manson family begins in 1967 with Manson's release from federal prison. A clean-cut Charlie getting out after 7 years. His destination was San Francisco. The ex-con walked in on the psychedelic summer of love.
One pill makes you larger, and one pill makes you small.
In the capital of flower power, San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury, Joel Fort was famous as the so-called hippie doctor.
The majority were idealists. They recognized that there were certain inequities and irrationalities and absurdities in American society, and they wanted to produce a more utopian society. They tended to be very imaginative in the use of color, in variety of clothing, in various kinds of art.
In 1967, Charles Manson wanted to be part of it.
So he said, geez, these little girls running around just about asking for it. It's not the same world I left from, you know. And he says, it's just unbelievable, a convict's dream.
I went down on the Hayden, I seen all these young kids. I was going to sing in the clubs. And I had learned to sing these kind of songs. The boat rides on the lake. And I went over and Ray Lee told me, he says, man, you can't do anything. He said, they're out there playing rock and roll.
You say yes, I say no.
Now, Manson needed money. He prowled the hippie enclaves looking for a woman to live with and live off, ending up on the campus in Berkeley. The University of California here in Berkeley was seething in the late 1960s with rebellion against the Vietnam War and authority in general. Charles Manson came here, saw all of it, but ignored the politics. He had other things on his mind. Specifically, a university librarian named Mary Bruner. She didn't know it at the time, but she was the first member of the Manson family. Lynette Squeaky Frome was the second. Squeaky, he bragged, I am the god of sex. Then Manson put the family on the road.
I'm going up the country, baby, don't you want?
The family traveled and lived in a Volkswagen bus, cruising the California coast from Big Sur to Los Angeles. Hippie girls were recruited with the promise of free drugs, free sex, and what Manson said was free thinking.
He was kind of like their psychologist, and he'd listen to them and then tell them what their problems were, and this struck a responsive chord.
That receptive person interacts with that, and then the drug or isolation or certain sexual practices such as Manson exposed them to sort of put them under his influence.
Manson discovered he could influence his followers best with the hallucinogenic drug, LSD.
Lucy in the sky with diamonds.
When your head explodes into like an oversized warm balloon, you nod for a few minutes from overstimulation, you're wired for 3 days.
The Manson family took countless acid trips, but Manson himself indulged only occasionally. Charlie didn't want to be out of control, he wanted to be in control.
If you happen to have the kind of personality, the kind of mind that is inclined towards a lack of morality and inclined towards hatred, the intensity of this drug's effect can interact with your instability and your anger.
As the family grew, one girl became known as the angriest, Susan Atkins. She was the one who stabbed Sharon Tate.
She met Manson in the Haight-Ashbury district, walking down the street, handed him a flower, and he invited her back to his apartment.
Patricia Krenwinkel became a stabbing, slashing murderess. But in the beginning, she was just a beach girl.
Krenwinkel is a very homely person, and Manson paid attention to her, and there were very few men that ever paid attention to her, and so she got sucked in by that method.
The prettiest of the Manson girls, Leslie Van Houten, left a young, handsome lover for Charlie and later killed for him. But in 1967, violence was still in the family's future.
I don't think he was contemplating murder when he formed this family. It was love, LSD, etc. But he started seeing all the control that he had over these people.
Then Manson's dreams of peace and love began turning into nightmares of hatred and violence.
I know your fears. I see through your minds.
Inside the mind of Manson and his followers, past and present, continues in a moment. In 1969, the night Sharon Tate was murdered, the 60s flower power wilted. The flower children grew up with a chilling jolt of reality. Our Doug Bruckner continues his investigation of the real Charles Manson.
You say you want a revolution, well, you know.
The young people of the 60s were driven by drugs, protest, but most of all by music. And the Manson family was right in the groove. Charles Manson wanted to be a rock star, and he became a disciple of the Beatles. When the Beatles' drug-inspired White Album came out in 1968, Manson made it his testament. The Beatles and Charles Manson saw life differently. The group had no idea when they cut the raw rock track Helter Skelter that they were recording rhythms for mass murder. For a time, the Manson family actually penetrated the world of rock stars, but their entree wasn't through anyone connected to the Beatles. They began hanging out with, of all people, the Beach Boys.
If everybody had a move across the USA.
Charles Manson says he met Beach Boys drummer Dennis Wilson in one of Charlie's haunts in San Francisco.
Charlie had gone into this friend. He used to exchange grass for some hallucinogenic drugs. So one time who was there, who knocks on the door but Dennis Wilson. So the dealer, he introduced him. Hey, you two should know each other anyway. You're both into music.
2 weeks later, he comes back from a recording session at about 2 a.m. and Manson's at his door. Dennis walks in. Manson had moved his family in. They were smoking marijuana, eating cookies, and Dennis thought it was kind of a fun situation. They lived with Dennis for several months.
But by the time they'd moved out of Wilson's gated mansion, the Beach Boy had lost most of his gold records and his Rolls Royce. It was the Beach Boys drummer who took Charles Manson to this canyon house, a fateful outing that set the stage for the murders of 5 people. The house would later be rented by actress Sharon Tate and her new husband, Roman Polanski. When Manson visited, record producer Terry Melcher lived here.
Manson is a frustrated singer-guitarist, and Manson prevailed upon Melcher to record him commercially. Melcher did give him an interview and audition. He wasn't very impressed with him. He gave him $50 and he walked away.
I had 1,000 dreams like sharp knives on sewing machines, and my mind just raced away.
Was music the motive for the murder of Sharon Tate and the others? Did Manson send the killers here to get even? There are clues to that mystery in the prison video. Manson still dreams of winning acceptance for his music.
I'd like to get back outside and just be anybody, someone just like you. Or if you don't want that, let me go back and play some music and walk around where I just came from. I was doing this when I got arrested. It's how I express myself. Tired as caveman trip. I'm gonna take over everything. I already did. We put it in motion.
Manson's murder plot was put into motion on the Spahn Ranch shortly after Manson's musical career fell apart. There was a sinister new face around now, Charles Watson, Tex. He'd been a high school athlete, a straight arrow. Now at Spahn Ranch, Tex started to say, "I am Charlie. And Charlie is me."
Tex Watson would hold training classes on how to murder, how to stab somebody, that you didn't just put the knife in, that when you put the knife in, you pulled up on the knife. And we found a number of the stab wounds in the Tate-LaBianca murders where the knife had been put into a victim and somebody had pulled up on it to do more damage.
This was the site of the Spahn Ranch. The buildings have been long since cleared away. In the 60s, there were many communes like the Manson family with drugs and open sex. Unlike the others, the Manson family's priority was to make war, not love. The family had an arsenal of guns and knives. In the summer of 69, the time to use them was getting near.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
On July 20th, 1969, the world stopped to watch a man walk on the moon. 3 weeks later, with everyone's eyes still fixed on the heavens, Charles Manson announced to the family his vision of hell on Earth. Helter Skelter, Manson told his women, would start with brutal murders of whites. Blacks would be blamed. A race war would start. Before he sent the women with Watson to the Tate house, Manson directed, "Kill everyone as gruesome as you can."
The evil mystique of Charles Manson lies in the eyes of gullible, desperate followers. But a frightening reality, there are many still out there. More in a moment. Hundreds of women write to Charles Manson in his jail cell today, some barely in their teens. A look at the bizarre Manson spell as our Doug Bruckner's investigation continues.
In August 1969, Charles Manson had never felt more powerful. His family had just slaughtered actress Sharon Tate and four others. They hadn't ignited a race war, but they'd made headlines around the world and apparently gotten away with it. Police were baffled. Manson had used sex, drugs, and mind control to make the family do his bidding, to kill each member's ego. But he was betrayed by a girl whose ego couldn't be killed, the one he named after a Beatles song.
Sexy Sadie, what have you done?
Sexy Sadie's real name was Susan Atkins. She was under arrest for the murder of musician Gary Hinman, who Manson thought had burned him.
And while she was in custody in Civil Brand, she blabbed to two of her cellmates about Manson and the Tate-LaBianca murders. When she was telling the two women Susan laughed and said that Sharon, who was 8.5 months pregnant at the time, was crying and just begging for her baby. She said, "All I want to do is have my baby. Please let me have my baby." She looked at Sharon in the eye and said, "Look, bitch, I don't care about you, and I don't care whether or not you're going to have a baby. You're going to die, and you better be ready, and I don't care a thing about it."
The trial in 1971 chilled America nearly as much as the murders, the family's street corner vigils, those X's cut into the foreheads.
The jury sentenced all of them to death. And then in 1972, in a case called Furman versus Georgia, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that the death penalty, as it was then being carried out, was unconstitutional.
The unthinkable became possible. After 7 years behind bars, Charles Manson would become eligible for parole.
"Why don't you guys let me out of here so I can walk around and do what I want to do, ride around, just be whoever I was. I lost it. Couldn't remember my ID."
Manson's guards say he fantasizes about returning to, appropriately, Death Valley, where he was living on this desert ranch when he was arrested.
"I live out in the desert. For a good reason. You couldn't make it in the desert. Because you couldn't give up all your creature comforts. You couldn't give up all your pie doughs and your aerosol cans. But if everybody was to stop and go out into the desert and just walk in the desert and forget and go the other way."
And if Manson were released, there would be no shortage of young people willing to go the other way with him. Hard copy was shown Manson fan letters delivered to prison by the pound, gifts of music tapes, requests for his autograph, but mostly people seeking his direction, wanting to join the family. A 13-year-old girl writes that Charlie can move in with her. Another teenager closes with the words, "Helter Skelter." Does she know the horror those words symbolize?